So I'll be teaching you multi-phase reactor design and typically 30 to 40 hours, actual hours. And what I plan is on every Thursday, we start at 3:30, we'll begin like that. And at about 5 o'clock, we'll take 15 minutes break and then again continue for 1 hour or more or less, depending upon your condition, my condition, we'll do accordingly. Reactors are, of course, heart of chemical industry, and there are approximately 300 different types of reactors which are used in chemical industry. Fortunately, we need not study the design procedure of each one of them. The method is generalized, and it is definitely a chemical engineering method. We use whatever subjects we have learnt up till now. You have studied reaction engineering, you have studied fluid mechanics, you have studied transport phenomena, that is mass transfer you have studied, heat transfer you have studied, process control you have studied. In mathematics you have studied algebraic equations, nonlinear, linear, ordinary differential equations, partial differential equations, right? So all this knowledge cumulatively we'll try to use it for reactor design. The reactor design, definitely we will come out with certain dimensions, but real skill is required in recommending optimum design, whether we can miniaturize the design. At present, in a variety of industries, batch processes are being used, which result into huge capital cost. Anyway, current design procedures, they result into huge capital cost, and capital cost has a burden on the final cost of production. So the real objective of this course will be to teach you a generalized method for the design, and which includes any equipment and all the equipment, right? And optimum design in such a way that it is cost effective. And how to understand the cost effectiveness, that also I will teach you. I'll teach this course in 4 parts. Multi-phase reactor, is that title of your course? Multi-phase reactor design, what is the title? Or design of multi-phase reactors? Multi-phase. Recently, I met head of chemical engineering of MIT, and he specifically complimented our institution that your students are better equipped in terms of reaction engineering and reactor design. So let us continue with that strength. Let us acquire that strength, acquire in such a way that we are able to implement, and you will get an opportunity next year for home paper. The project that you will do, use all this information for the optimum design of equipment. So the 4 steps are, in the first step, I'm going to tell you the classification, how these equipment are classified. Backside, are you able to read? There has to be some light, no? It seems to be removed. Are you able to read backside? Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Classification, and qualitative description. This is part one, and I could describe all 300 reactors, but which will consume time. Time is never a problem, time is always there, but it is not required. If I describe to you about say 25 to 30, practically all the others, they get described. I will classify also. And that subject I will begin with today. The second one is determination of rate controlling step. And estimation of overall rate of reaction. The third one, the actual process design. Actual process design and optimization. And fourth one is estimation of design parameters. You must have studied the subjects of heat transfer or unit operations, and obviously heard the terms like heat transfer coefficient, interfacial area, fractional liquid holdup, and similar to that. And getting the values of these parameters for a variety of equipment is most difficult step in chemical engineering. This step is right now handled empirically, that is several experiments are done in the laboratory for the measurement of such parameters, and eventually some dimensionless correlations are given, and you are familiar with say Dittus-Bolter equation, where Nusselt number is related to Reynolds number and Prandtl number, and for mass transfer Sherwood number is related to Reynolds number and Schmidt number, and there are many other correlations. For power consumption also there are some correlations. So why there is a particular condition because of which chemical engineers they need to do such empiricism, this I am going to describe to you in great detail. And in order to reduce the empiricism, in order to improve our confidence, in order to optimize the reactors, what are the current steps being taken worldwide, what is the way in which new knowledge is being generated for reducing the empiricism, that also I will describe to you. So that is not written here, but let me write forth is estimation of design parameters. I'm also going to teach you after explaining the four-step procedure, the most complex case in chemical engineering. I will consider in great detail how to execute these four steps and how to carry out. There are several reactions in gas phase, several reactions in liquid phase. Absorption is accompanied by a chemical reaction. Desorption is preceded by chemical reaction. There are gas phase equilibria, there are liquid phase equilibria, there are heterogeneous equilibria, there are some endothermic reactions, there are some exothermic reactions. So whenever such a complex situation is there, I want to remove any fear associated with the design. So after you understand that example, you are of course welcome to ask me questions. But when you understand that example, the fear will go away, right? If such complex and this design procedure has been actually implemented industrial size reactors are in successful operation, not one, plenty of them, right? So there is a huge confidence behind it, and I wish to impart all that confidence to you so that you will be able to do a good job later. So we'll start with step one, the classification of all reactors and the qualitative description. The qualitative description I am giving just to expose you to the hardware of variety of equipment and what is the methodology of contacting different phases in different equipment. All right? So we'll start with step one. Maybe I can do this. Sometimes I may use PowerPoint projection. I will use it only few times. I'll teach with chalk and board. For performing any operation, right? Walking, sitting, writing, listening, think of anything, any operation, energy is required, right? And for operating any one of these reactors, energy is required. And we know classification of mechanical energy, potential energy, kinetic energy and pressure energy, right? So all the reactors are classified the way in which they use the energy. If they use pressure energy, then that category is called pressure energy reactors. They use kinetic energy, then these are kinetic energy, and similarly the potential energy reactors. So I will be describing to you maybe 7-8 reactors in each category so that you will get fair amount of idea how the other equipment can be quickly understood on the basis of the discussion which will happen here. So the classification, one is pressure energy, so you have multi-phase reactors. And these are classified as per the is the pressure energy, the kinetic energy, and potential energy. So in pressure energy, the equipment are now, next 1 minute you don't write anything. The bubble columns, packed bubble columns, external loop airlift reactors, internal loop airlift reactors, sectionalized bubble columns, packed beds, solid liquid fluidized bed, gas solid fluidized bed, all kinds of loop reactors, gas liquid solid fluidized beds, gas liquid liquid fluidized beds. So whatever names I have said just now, I am going to describe them, all of them to you. The most probably I might have said about 7 or 8, but which I will describe to you. And all of them use pressure energy. Prior to that, let me tell you one nomenclature. You can visualize bubbles. Can you visualize bubbles in liquid? Right? Can you visualize particles in liquid? Can you visualize particles in gas? Right? Either particles supported by upward flowing of air or particles settling in the gas medium. The drops in air. Have you seen shower any time? Every day morning, right? Where the drops are dispersed in gas, right? So dispersed phases are bubbles, drops, and particles. Either bubbles in liquid, the liquid in another immiscible liquid, like drop of benzene in water, or a liquid drop in air, or particles in liquid or particle in gas. So the particles, where the particles are discrete, they are not continuous, whereas particles in liquid, the liquid medium is continuous, right? Similarly, particles in gas or drops in gas, the drops are discontinuous from each other, whereas the gas phase is continuous. So the nomenclature is, whatever is dispersed, we write that phase first, and the continuous, we write it as a second phase. So if there are gas liquid equipment, this means liquid is continuous phase and gas is dispersed phase in the form of bubbles. Liquid liquid multiphase reactors, liquid liquid spray columns, liquid liquid rotating disc contactors. So you name any equipment later on, first liquid means the dispersed drops, and another liquid means the continuous phase, liquid phase, which is immiscible as far as the dispersed phase is concerned, right? So in the category of the pressure energy reactors, first of all I will explain to you gas liquid reactors, then liquid liquid reactors, then solid liquid reactors, then solid gas reactors, and then gas liquid solid reactors. And the nomenclature I have, is there any difficulty? Have you understood? You are able to visualize the bubbles, drops, and particles. Normally, whenever we try to understand such a subject, we say only dispersed phase and not bubble or drop or particle, or together we may say a particle, and a continuous phase, which is either gas or liquid. That makes the entire procedure generalized procedure. Otherwise, learning all the design procedure for 300 reactors, first of all, it is not possible. Secondly, it is not desirable. Then we don't understand the fundamentals behind it. What is the meaning of design, and what are the different steps which are encountered in the design? If we understand that, then if there are 300 reactors right now, and if we optimize some of them, then it is likely that you will come up with one more reactor which is even more efficient if you understand the generalized design procedure, right? If you understand 300 separately, then you won't be able to do that. While learning in this class, we are going to make one assumption, right? And that assumption is, we know nothing. Is that good assumption? Even if you know something, let us begin with, we know nothing, right? That is, you have been given an actual industrial example which is to be implemented. You design equipment for the manufacture of something, where obviously the raw materials are known, and the raw materials may be in the form of gas phase, liquid phase, and solid phase. But our starting point is, we know nothing. Means, we don't know the mechanism of reaction, we don't know kinetics of reaction, we don't know the transport phenomena within the equipment, we don't know what are the possible geometries of the reactor, right? So therefore, and the next statement and the previous statement, that we know nothing, and the next statement is, since we know nothing, we try to design all the reactors, right? And if we do it few times, quickly we realize, we understand that for a particular class of applications, this is a good idea. For another class, this is a good idea. And slowly, the experience builds up. I recommend this particular procedure rather than somebody telling you that design a stirred tank reactor for something. You design all gas liquid equipment and let the answer come from within, with an assumption that we did not know anything to start with, and now several answers have come which they themselves are telling which one is the attractive solution, which is a good solution, right? So let us start with gas liquid reactors within pressure energy. So within pressure energy, let me start with gas liquid reactors. Then obviously, will be liquid-liquid and solid-liquid and solid-gas, all of them. But when I describe gas-liquid in great detail, where gas phase in the form of bubbles is a dispersed phase and liquid is continuous phase, you can imagine other reactors, say liquid-liquid or solid-liquid, in a similar manner, because the overall performance and overall geometries and overall methods of contacting, they are identical. They are identical. So let me expose you to variety of gas liquid equipment. I need to explain to you why such reactors are called pressure energy reactors. So the simplest gas liquid equipment is a bubble column. It is a vertical cylindrical vessel. with gas distributor at the bottom. So there is a certain liquid level. So at the bottom of the reactor, we know that the pressure, which is static pressure, is equal to rho gh. If there is a liquid and there is a certain density and height of the liquid is known, then the pressure at the bottom is rho gh. And if we want to introduce gas at the bottom, it has to be pressurized at least to rho gh so that at least one bubble can go inside, right? When such a gas phase gets introduced inside in the form of several bubbles, since the gas was pressurized first and gas liquid dispersion happened, which is a gas liquid reactor, therefore, it is called a pressure energy reactor. The energy is supplied to the equipment, to bubble column, by pressurizing the gas at the bottom at least or greater than the static head of liquid within the equipment, right? So this is a pressure energy reactor. So there is a distributor at the bottom. You can imagine a sieve plate, a plate with holes, and next time I am going to show you a variety of designs of distributors, the spiders and the concentric rings and many more, and how to select them, that also I'll teach you. But when gas is pressurized and the gas now appears in the form of bubbles, there are two regimes in which the bubbles are seen inside. Little difficult, attend for next few sentences. The bubbles which are introduced at the bottom, this is a perforated plate, a plate having holes, and pressurized gas comes, and every hole is making bubble, and bubbles are getting introduced inside and they are rising. So when bubbles are, while they are rising, if the concentration is uniform throughout and if all of them are rising with uniform velocity, if concentration is uniform throughout means there is a uniformity in terms of number of bubbles per unit volume, and we call this multiphase reactor to operate in homogeneous regime, right? So let me draw bubbles in such a way that visually at least you will see the concentration is uniform. So what are the characteristic features? The bubbles which are introduced at the sparger, they rise without any interaction with other bubbles. No breakup occurs, no coalescence occurs. All of them rise independently with exactly the same rise velocity. That is called homogeneous regime. So these are the characteristic features. I had written one chapter, there is a chemical engineering handbook edited by Albright, and I will request the monitor, I think let us have one monitor or three monitors, one PhD monitor, one chemical. Who is chemistry monitor? Yeah, okay. The masters, right, and PhD. PhD, I will have to appoint somebody. Would you? Anybody? Any volunteer? Good. So there is the chapter I had written in the handbook. So you distribute the chapter, the soft copy, to everybody. So whatever sentences I am uttering just now, there is a homogeneous phase. The bubbles generated at the sparger, they rise without interacting with each other, without any coalescence or breakup, with exactly the same rise velocity, and concentration of bubbles is uniform throughout, and it is called homogeneous regime. All these sentences you will find there, right? So let me draw the homogeneous regime. So in a liquid which had a certain level, when the bubbles are there is an expansion in height, and there is an expanded zone at the top, so that the gas phase can be efficiently separated from the liquid phase. That is the enhanced cross section, and here is the. So this is called, this is the increased height as compared to the original height which I had drawn, that is called clear liquid height. Or if we stop the gas, again dispersion will collapse and it will come to clean liquid height, which is, let us denote it by HC, is the clean liquid height. And this is the height of dispersion. One more nomenclature you please try to remember. Whenever we say volume of multiphase reactor, this means all the phases together. In this case, the volume of dispersion is the reactor volume. Right? If there are many more phases, like suppose there is a catalyst particles inside. So catalyst particles will occupy a certain volume, but as far as we are concerned, the total volume of all the phases within the reactor, they form, that is called as the volume of the reactor. Right? So this is the height of dispersion, this is clear liquid height, this is the distributor. Now the distributor is designed in such a way. See, if gas is not passed, the liquid will start, and the word used in chemical engineering is liquid starts weeping through the holes. Weeping, you understand? Very easy. Right. So if we pass the gas through the holes in such a way that the weeping of liquid is prevented. So the number of holes and size of holes are selected in such a way that the pressure drop across the holes is sufficient enough so that the weeping is prevented. Right? So here in this portion there is no liquid, and this is called gas chamber. This is actual gas liquid dispersion. And this is called disengagement zone. this part is called disengagement. Now gas is passing continuously and getting released at the top. So as shown here, gas phase enters inside continuously and leaves the equipment continuously, right? Please try to understand. The nomenclature which I told you, gas liquid dispersion, means gas is dispersed phase and liquid is a continuous phase, right? Now this nomenclature is the form in which the phase appears in the equipment. The dispersed form is bubbles, drops and particles. The second sentence I said, the gas phase is moving continuously within the equipment. It is entering at the bottom and leaving at the top. So we should never confuse ourselves between the, what is the nomenclature, dispersed in the multiphase reactor, and the way in which the phase flows across the equipment, right? Here the liquid is in batch mode, and in batch mode of liquid we are passing gas, right? We are calling this gas liquid dispersion, where liquid is continuous phase, right? But liquid is in batch mode, but there is a possibility of introducing liquid at the top and for maintaining the same height of dispersion, we take out the liquid from the bottom, and this will be then counter current. Liquid is flowing downwards and gas is flowing upwards, the counter current gas liquid reactor. Or there can be inlet at the bottom and outlet at the top, and this is called a co-current operation. So co-current or counter-current operation. Maybe co-current I will show on one side and counter-current on the other side. Co-current. And then it is taken out, which is of course counter current. We have understood what is the meaning of homogeneous dispersion. Not that the homogeneous dispersion occurs only for gas liquid. Liquid drops in liquid, that can also be homogeneous dispersion. Solid particles in liquid, that can be also homogeneous dispersion. So homogeneity is a regime of operation of multiphase reactor, and obviously the other regime is heterogeneous regime. And heterogeneity is in terms of concentration of either bubbles or drops or particles per unit volume within the equipment, right? So what it means, very simple, the concentration of bubbles maybe at the center is high, and as we go radially outwards, the number of bubbles per unit volume, it decreases. The concentration is different, radially changing, and therefore that is called heterogeneous operation, right? In heterogeneous operation, the bubbles which are formed at the interface, whatever sentences I said at the beginning, in the homogeneous regime, the bubbles formed at the interface, they rise without interacting with any other bubbles. No breakup happens, no coalescence happens, all of them rise with exactly the same rise velocity. So that is called homogeneous regime. Now the all these sentences, you make them reverse, and that is called heterogeneous regime. The bubble concentration per unit volume is not uniform within the equipment, particularly in the radial direction. The bubbles which are generated at the bottom, they do not rise with the same velocity. They interact with each other, bubble coalescence happens, bubble breakup happens, right? And that is called heterogeneous regime. Since there is a possibility of coalescence and dispersion, there is a bubble size distribution in heterogeneous regime. There are, in some regions there are smaller bubbles, in some other region there are bigger bubbles. So in heterogeneous regime there is a non-uniformity of bubble sizes, or there is a bubble size distribution, whereas in homogeneous regime all the bubbles are more or less of the same size. So these are the characteristic features. So typically, let me draw a heterogeneous regime. We are with step one, classification, pressure energy, kinetic energy, and potential energy. Within pressure energy, I'm qualitatively describing all types of reactors within that category, and we have started with bubble column. And what is shown on the board is homogeneous regime. And let us see heterogeneous regime. For the benefit of everybody, keep silence all the time. Keep silence. If something there is urgent, you can always have a word with me and we can handle all the urgent situations, right? But keep silence. So this is gas in and this is gas out. Right? So the gas leaves. And this is liquid. What is going out is countercurrent liquid. There is a height of dispersion. Now the only difference from the homogeneous dispersion is there is a bubble size distribution, so there are somewhere bigger bubbles. And then there are smaller bubbles as well. You must have seen deliberately I have drawn bigger bubbles at the center and smaller bubbles at the wall. Because that is truth. That is what exactly happens in actual bubble column. There is a coalescence and breakup, small bubbles get concentrated. So here there is a non-uniformity of concentration of bubbles and here is a heterogeneous regime. So if we plot certain volume of gas liquid dispersion is occupied by gas, and that gas volume divided by total volume of gas and liquid put together is called gas fraction, right? Or in chemical engineering, it is called fractional gas holdup, fractional gas holdup. Similarly, there is fractional liquid holdup, and obviously the fractional gas holdup and fractional liquid holdup put together is equal to 1, right? So the if we plot fractional gas hold up, versus superficial gas velocity, the word superficial means volumetric flow rate divided by total cross section of the equipment. So if you are passing gas say at 5 m³/s and if the cross section is 5 m², then the superficial velocity is 1 m/s. We do not worry while expressing superficial velocity what is the fraction of gas, what is the fraction of liquid, as if nothing is there or everything is there, but we divide volumetric flow rate of gas by total cross section. There will be similarly superficial liquid velocity, volumetric flow rate of liquid divided by cross section, that will be called superficial gas velocity. So we will start using certain nomenclature and which will keep constant throughout the course. Let us call this as superficial gas velocity. Maybe those who are on the backside, they may not be able to see. I'm sure you have understood these two diagrams, and now I don't need them just now. Okay, let them be there for some time. Superficial gas velocity. Velocity V with subscript G is superficial gas velocity. Y-axis is fractional gas holdup denoted by epsilon G. When the regime is homogeneous, when the gas flow rate is increased or when superficial velocity is increased, the number of bubbles which are getting inside the equipment through the spargers, those number of bubbles are proportional to superficial gas velocity. And since all the bubbles are rising, with equal velocity without interacting with each other, the gas holdup increases linearly with superficial gas velocity. Okay? So epsilon G increases linearly with gas velocity, mainly because number of bubbles are proportional to the superficial gas velocity, and all the sizes of bubbles, they don't change with respect to superficial gas velocity. The next 10 minutes, I'm going to teach you something which is normally very difficult. I have been teaching this subject for several years, and this portion, every year students find it difficult to understand. So I suggest all of you to concentrate all your energy towards whatever I'm saying next 10 minutes. Right? And the subject is transition of homogeneous regime to heterogeneous regime and behavior of gas holdup during transition. That is the subject, right? The homogeneous regime we have understood, I have said it so many times. Because of some reason, there is a disturbance. There may be fluctuation in superficial gas velocity, maybe by 4-5%. While bubbles are rising, as the concentration increases, in homogeneous regime, we definitely wanted that there should not be any interaction, but because of fluctuation, some interaction happens as the concentration increases. When the concentration is say 5% up to say even 10%, they may not interact with each other. But when it becomes 20%, 25%, and that percentage concentration up to which homogeneity remains maintained depends upon the type of gas liquid system. I am going to teach that in great detail, what is the meaning of type of gas liquid system. But up to that hold up, the homogeneity remains and the interaction starts, right? And because of interaction, at least temporarily, the gas holdup is more in certain region as compared to some other region. The pressure at the bottom, the pressure at the bottom is proportional to or is equal to h rho g, where rho is the density. And in gas liquid dispersion, the density is the combined density of gas and liquid above that point, correct? So when concentration of gas phase is non-uniform, the pressure at the bottom is also non-uniform, right? And if there is pressure distribution at the bottom, if there is pressure distribution at the bottom, suppose as shown here, there are more bubbles in the central region as compared to number of bubbles at the wall, right? So when number of bubbles are more here, the pressure in the central region, the pressure is, suppose I call this as point A, and the corresponding pressure PA, which is equal to, if HD is height of dispersion, then rho L epsilon L plus rho G epsilon G into G is the static pressure above that point. And near the wall, if the point is B, then PB will be, actually in terms of equation, it will be the same. HD rho L epsilon L plus rho G epsilon G into G. You will quickly realize that in this combined density, air density or gas densities are typically 1000 times less than liquid phase densities. So rho g epsilon g term is negligible in this combined density. And when we say that gas holdup is more in the central region, this means liquid holdup is less and liquid holdup is more. What is then PB is greater than PA. As a result, what happens? Whenever there is a pressure driving force, flow will start. Let me draw yet another column. Point B and point A. Of course, near the another wall, there is another point B. Since PB is greater than PA, the liquid flow starts and then it goes upwards, it comes downwards. Again, from B, it comes to A, goes up and comes down. There is a upflow, there is a downflow. So because of the heterogeneity of distribution of gas phase, more concentration and less concentration, that has resulted into intense liquid circulation inside. And what is the order of magnitude? Let me tell you what is the order of magnitude, because we have all the equations ready here from which we can find out what is the order of magnitude of such circulation. But while differentiating between homogeneous and heterogeneous regime, now we have one more point, that the liquid circulation prevails in heterogeneous regime, whereas it is totally absent in the homogeneous regime. Because in homogeneous regime there is uniformity of concentration, there is no question of distribution of static pressure profiles at the bottom and no reason for liquid circulation, right? So liquid circulation is absent in homogeneous regime, whereas it strongly prevails in the heterogeneous regime. And how to calculate? We know the pressure difference and we know Bernoulli's equation, the pressure energy, the kinetic energy, the potential energy, all of them put together, the sum is the same. And if we wish to write PB is greater than PA, so the pressure driving force is PB minus PA, this is equal to, if we write PB, I am writing density to be negligible. I think I will not take steps, I will write all the steps in between. PB is greater than PA, since rho g is negligibly small as compared to rho l, PB is equal to HD into rho l into epsilon l in the central region, whereas PA, B is in the near wall region, whereas PA is in the central region, HD epsilon L, epsilon L in the central region. Or PB is greater than PA, so PB minus PA, HD into G is common, so into bracket epsilon L near the wall minus epsilon L at the center, which I can easily write HD into G. Since gas holdup and liquid holdup put together is always 1 at any point. So the difference between gas holdup, I can write the difference in liquid holdup, the difference in liquid holdup, I can write difference in gas holdup, epsilon L, epsilon g at the center minus epsilon g at the wall. So whatever is delta epsilon g, that is the pressure driving force. And if the liquid circulation velocity, this intensity is say Vc circulation velocity, then this is equal to, this is the pressure driving force is equal to Vc square upon 2. I have equated the pressure driving force with the kinetic energy. I wanted to tell you what is the order of magnitude, and take any delta epsilon g where maybe just 5%, right? And height of the equipment, let us take 10 meters. So basically what we have written is Vc square upon 2 is Hd into g into delta epsilon g, the difference between the holdups between the center and the wall, correct? And let us take equal to just 5%, 0.05%. G is 9.81, and the height of the equipment we have taken 10 meters is equal to Vc square by 2.
Please calculate value of VC.
You don't have, next time onwards bring calculators, everybody. Now you use whatever you have. 4.908. Let me write 4.9 meters per second. Tell me the new answer. 5.81. So tell me it's correct. Somebody else also? 3.1. Okay. For the last 5-7 minutes prior to that, I said I'm going to teach you difficult subject, and class after class they find it difficult to understand. I have not yet completed. All right. The difficult portion perhaps has yet to come. All right. So, rho should be here. 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 And therefore, the answer is no. Rho will cancel from both the sides. No. Just check up. The kinetic energy is rho Vc square by 2. What I had written earlier was specific kinetic energy and specific potential energy, that is energy per unit mass. The bubble rise velocities are of the order of say 0.1 meter per second. Big bubbles 0.2 meter per second, 0.3 meter per second, maximum 0.5 meter per second. All right. Whereas just because of difference in hold up by 5%, there is a liquid velocity which is generated is 3 meters per second. Now if the concentration in the central region is more and there is upward liquid velocity at the whatever is the rate, the gas phase is driven out at a faster rate. Whereas in the annular region closer to the wall, wherever there is a downward velocity, the bubble phase, the gas phase is retained within the equipment. Right? So in the central region, the gas phase is driven out, whereas in the near wall region, it is retained. But since the gas holdup is more in the central region, the net effect of driving out the gas and retaining the gas is there is less gas fraction remaining within the equipment. Should I repeat? This question, should I repeat? In every class, I repeat 10 times. Let me tell you the key features, key points. In homogeneous regime, the concentration is uniform and all the bubbles are rising with same velocity. If the bubble size is of the order of 1 millimeter, the rise velocity is 0.1 meter per second. If these are 4 millimeters, then about 0.22 meter per second. If the bubbles are of 12, 15 millimeters, they rise with 0.4 meter per second. If there are 15, 20 millimeter diameter, then 0.5 meter per second, correct? So these are bubble rise velocities. The pressure at the bottom is equal to the local static head above that point, which is rho gh, right, which is rho gh. And whenever there is a concentration fluctuation, difference in concentration, and we have taken 5%, the resulting pressure difference, the static pressure difference near the wall and at the center, that number is there, which generates the liquid circulation inside, and we have equated the kinetic energy with pressure energy, and we got liquid circulation of the order of 3.1 meter per second, which is very high as compared to what is the normal range of the bubble rise velocities, maximum 0.5 meter per second, right. So what will happen because of liquid circulation, which is upward in the central region where there are more gas bubbles and there are less gas bubbles near the wall where there is a downward liquid motion. The bubbles in the central region, they are driven out because of the liquid circulation, the upward velocity in the central region, right. Imagine homogeneous regime, and now you superimpose liquid circulation above the homogeneous regime, the bubbles in the central region, where in the heterogeneous regime, obviously there are more number of bubbles, they are driven out. And near the wall, the bubbles are retained because there is a downward liquid velocity. So there is a retention and there is a reduction in number of bubbles in the central region because of the upward liquid velocity. And since there are more number of bubbles in the central region, the net effect of bubbles being driven out and bubbles retaining within the column near the wall, the net effect is number of bubbles in the column decrease as compared to homogeneous regime. I have explained second time. Should I repeat? Raise your hands. Should I repeat? Yeah. What is that I am trying to explain? In the homogeneous regime, I have already drawn the gas hold up with superficial gas velocity. And whatever is drawn is in the homogeneous regime, because the number of bubbles are directly proportional to volumetric flow rate of gas, and therefore it is proportional to superficial gas velocity. Correct? So that linear relationship breaks when the heterogeneity happens, and the gas hold up after the heterogeneity breaks is less than if, say for example, the transition would not have occurred, then infinitely the gas hold up will increase. The point I am explaining now is in heterogeneous regime, the gas hold up is less than what it would have been if homogeneous regime would have persisted. That point I am explaining, correct? So the first point within that was, whenever there is heterogeneity, there is liquid circulation, and which is upward in the central region, downward near the wall. And basic heterogeneity is, there are more number of bubbles in the central region and less number of bubbles near the wall, correct? Liquid circulation is of course the same, but the upward liquid velocity in the central region, it is taking bubbles with it, and the bubbles are driven out at a certain rate, correct? And there are more number of bubbles. You imagine two compartments, one is annular region and one is the central region, right? So in the central region, the reduction in concentration of bubbles is much more because there are more number of bubbles than the number of bubbles which are retained near the wall. And the net effect is that more number of bubbles are driven out, and the gas hold up now is less than the hold up which would have existed if homogeneous regime would have persisted. Should I repeat? Are you surprised to me? Is it truth? Because I keep on explaining. 6 times, 7 times, and only I have explained how many times? 3 times. Yeah, yeah, very good, excellent. I am very happy. But it should be truth, huh? Should be truth. So the hold up is less. The difficult part has yet to come. The difficult part has to come. The gas hold up increases, it goes through maxima, it goes through a minima, and again it increases. Definitely, whenever there is a transition, the hold up is less than the homogeneous regime. That much we have understood. But why there is maxima and minima, this is a little difficult. So what let us do, we will stop today and we will start with the point that why the gas holdup passes through maxima and minima, what is the role of liquid circulation so that the holdup attains a maxima and minima as we increase the gas velocity, or as the liquid circulation increases from zero, which is in the homogeneous regime, to a value of the order of 3 meter per second in heterogeneous regime, while the transition is occurring from 0 meter per second to 3 meter per second, the hold up passes through a maxima and minima. Correct? I am going to explain this to you. I do not expect you to understand. Okay? But be attentive, be attentive. The role of liquid circulation, the net effect of liquid circulation to drive out the gas, that much we have understood, right? When we increase the gas velocity, the number of bubbles which we are introducing inside the column, the number continuously increases with respect to superficial gas velocity. Understood? Let me repeat these two sentences. Let me reverse and say that the number of bubbles which are getting introduced inside the equipment, it increases with respect to gas velocity. And the role of liquid circulation, the role of liquid circulation is to drive out the gas, right? So whenever there is a small transition, the liquid velocity tries to drive away the gas, and the rate of increase of liquid circulation initially is so high that rate of driving out is much more than the rate at which the increased bubbles are getting inside. When liquid circulation is completely established, then of course bubbles are getting driven out and bubbles are being retained, but the number of bubbles which get introduced inside, they exceed the net effect of liquid circulation, and therefore we attain a minima, and again there is an increase in gas holdup. I said that I don't expect you to understand, and you have not understood. Is there anybody who has understood? I don't think so. Raise your hand. Yeah, of course. Yeah. So we will start with that, and I'll try to explain. This is the more or less the most difficult part of one of the difficult parts of reactor design. And many more will come, and we will have such occasions again and again. So we'll stop here, and we will meet next Thursday, and we will meet at 3:30, right? We'll meet at 3:30, and we'll continue for either 2.5 hours or 3 hours with a break of 15 to 20 minutes.